Hello everyone, welcome to our channel Gyan Kalyan. Myself Rajdeep Dhar. Presently I am pursuing my master degree in botany from Tripura University. Today I am gonna deal with the topic about PCR, polymerase chain reaction. So let's start. In this video we will discuss about PCR, that is polymerase chain reaction. This technique was given by Carey Mullis. This PCR is basically used for gene or DNA amplification. Whenever we use the term amplification, we are not really talking about the sound amplification. But here amplification means the number is to be increased. Suppose we find some DNA at the crime scene, maybe from a blood smear, and we know DNA can be isolated only from white blood cell. Red blood cell don't have nucleus. Platelets don't have nucleus, and as compared to red blood cell, the number of white blood cell is very less. Whatever few white blood cell we get, that is the only DNA or proof that we have from that crime scene. If we start using that much DNA only, and if something goes wrong, then complete proof or whatever clue we have, that is lost. So we want that DNA to be amplified. That means a number to be increased to a large number. It can be up to millions, so that if you are using some DNA for your research work or for your experimentation, and if something goes wrong, you still have the same DNA. PCR is also known as molecular photocopying. Its principle is based on the use of DNA polymerase, which is an in vitro replication of specific DNA sequences. PCR was discovered by Carey Mullis in 1983. Later in the year, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry along with Michael Smith for his work on PCR. Some important DNA polymerases used in PCR are TAC polymerase, VENT polymerase, deep VENT polymerase, and PFU polymerase. TAC polymerase is derived from Thermus aquaticus and it works at 94 degrees centigrade. VENT polymerase is derived from Thermococcus littoralis and it works at 98 degrees centigrade. Deep VENT polymerase is derived from Pyrococcus species and it works at 95 to 100 degrees centigrade. Even at 104 degrees centigrade, 3' to 5' exonucleus proofreading activity included. PFU polymerase is derived from Pyrococcus furiosus and it works at 100 to 104 degrees centigrade, proofreading activity included. When we use this technique, then we have to prepare a reaction mixture. There we have to take DNA template, primer, DNA polymerase, which have to be thermostable because this reaction will run on high temperature, DNTPs and buffer. After preparing this reaction mixture, we have to transfer this reaction mixture into PCR tube as showing in slide. After that, we have to put this PCR tube in machine for running a reaction. The PCR is completed in three steps. Number one, denaturation. Number two, annealing. And number three is elongation. So, denaturation is separation of two strands of DNA. The DNA that we get is a double-stranded DNA structure. As shown in the slide, the two strands are anti-parallel. We need to separate them so that each of these two strands, now the new DNA can be synthesized. So, in denaturation, we can use dilute hydrochloric acid, we can use dilute base, or we can use a high temperature. The process is used for denaturation, commonly is treating this DNA at high temperature. So, this temperature is about 90 to 94 degrees centigrade. And the DNA has to be kept at this temperature for a very, very short period of time. Because only the hydrogen bonds to be broken. If this temperature is given for a longer period of time, the DNA, even the phosphodiester bond, would be damaged. After this, the two DNA strands get separated. The polarity has to be remembered because the next step, this polarity is very important. So, by denaturation, the two strands have been separated. The bones which get broken are only hydrogen bones. Step number two is annealing. Annealing basically means hybridization. We want the separated DNA strands, new DNA strands should be synthesized. To synthesize a new DNA, there has to be a primer, which is required. Primer is a small fragment of RNA, which could initiate the DNA or nucleotides. Now, it is interesting that which end of the parent strand should the RNA primer be formed? Primer will always come at 3 prime end of the parent strand. So, what things required here to this process of annealing? In the process of annealing, requirements are RNA nucleotide, enzymes, and these steps takes place at a lower temperature, much lower than the denaturation. The temperature is about 50 to 60 degrees centigrade. Normally, 54 degrees centigrade or 56 degrees centigrade is the optimum temperature to take place. So now, we have a primer, that is RNA, and why it is known as an annealing, that is hybridization, because it is DNA-RNA hybrid, that's why it is known as hybridization. Step number 3 is elongation or extension. In elongation, the DNA nucleotides would come and bind with the primer. Let us talk about what all things are required in this process. This step takes place again at the higher temperature. 72 degrees centigrade is the optimum temperature at which this process takes place. We would require an enzyme for DNA synthesis, which is known as DNA polymerase. In our body, DNA polymerases do not work at 72 degrees centigrade. Our body temperature is 37 degrees centigrade. So, above these, all enzymes get denatured. So, we would need an enzyme which can work at such a high temperature. It should be thermostable or thermoliable. Such an enzyme is isolated from an archaebacteria, a thermophilus bacteria. The name is Thermus aquaticus. From Thermus aquatica, we obtain DNA polymerase. This bacterium, that is archaebacterium, it grows in hot water springs or it survives in hot water springs where the temperature is in between 200 degrees centigrade. So if it can survive in 100 degrees centigrade, all the enzymes must be thermostable. And from here, we isolate DNA polymerase. It is known as TAC polymerase. That means we have an enzyme which can work at this 72 degrees centigrade at higher temperature. And then we have to add DNA nucleotides. And these nucleotides now will get added to primer. And this is how a DNA nucleotide or new DNA strand would be synthesized. It is growing towards it 3 prime end. So when it comes in this last part, so now we have two starting from one parent strand and a new DNA synthesized, and from other parent strand other DNA synthesized. From this animated slide, we can see that we started with a single DNA, we separated those two, got primer attached to it, and from the primer, the DNA is synthesized. So starting from one, now we have two. So every time, if we repeat this process, the number of DNA gets doubled. Three steps. First is denaturation, where we separate. Temperature is important, which we have to remember. First step takes place at a very high temperature, that is 92 degrees centigrade. Secondly is annealing, which takes place quietly at lower temperature, that is 54 to 56 degrees centigrade. And thirdly, elongation, the third step. Two important things to be remembered in this process. This requires an enzyme which is capable of working at a very high temperature. We isolated from Thermus aquaticus. The name of the enzyme is TAC polymerase. It is the DNA polymerase and it works at 72, 74 degrees centigrade. But 72 degrees centigrade is the optimum temperature. And starting with one DNA, if we just do these three steps, we get two DNA strands. From two, we can get four DNA strands and so on. So we can do this repetition or perform this PCR till we reach a million DNAs. So from few DNA strands, which we get from anywhere, we can get whatever number of DNA that we need for the experiment or to be preserved for later use. So this polymerase chain reaction is used for DNA amplification. Different types of polymerase chain reaction are multiplex PCR, nested PCR, semi-quantitative PCR, RT-PCR, and real-time PCR. Multiplex PCR amplifies several DNA sequences, usually exonic sequences. Nested PCR increases the specificity of the amplified product for a second PCR with new primers that hybridize within the amplified fragment in the first PCR. Semi-quantitative PCR allows an approximation to the relative amount of nucleic acids present in the sample. RT-PCR generates amplification of RNA by synthesis of cDNA, DNA complementary to RNA, that is then amplified by PCR. Real-time PCR perform absolute and relative quantification of nucleic acid copies obtained by PCR. PCR has numerous applications. Number one, to amplify DNA for general molecular biology applications. Number two, the human immunodeficiency virus, so-called HIV, responsible for AIDS, is difficult to detect using antibody test unless the number of viruses are large enough. PCR tests have been developed that can detect infection as little as one viral genome among the DNA of over 50,000 host cells. Number three, PCR has been applied to many areas of research in molecular genetics, such as generating hybridization probes, DNA sequencing, and DNA cloning, etc. It is used for forensic science application in scenes of crime, disputes, DNA from blood, hair, tooth, etc. PCR has been used for analysis of microRNA, that is mRNA. For active latent viral infection determination, here reverse transcriptase PCR is applied for disease identification. It is used in the field of molecular archaeology for the fossil DNA analysis, and PCR is also used for detection of unknown mutations. After studying this technique, I came to know that by this technique, it makes possible of specific in vitro amplification of extremely small numbers of a DNA sequence up to amounts which we need for our study by conventional sequential techniques. Thank you. Stay safe.